Hi dear students, today we are discussing about the session 2, Business Economics and Financial Analysis. In the last class, we discussed about the introduction to business and economics. Then we discussed about the types of business entities. Now we are discussing about the types of business entities. In the last class, we discussed about the sole proprietorship, partnership we discussed, and today we are discussing about the joint stock companies. So first you should know the meaning of joint stock company. What is the meaning of joint stock company? So the joint stock company means a company formed and registered under this act or existing company. Under the Companies Act 1994, a joint stock company is an association of many persons who contribute money or money's worth to a common stock and employ it for a common purpose. Joint stock company is a new venture in the big business area. After industrial revolution, there must be change in the production system. So as per the Registered Companies Act 1994, a joint stock company is an association of many persons who contribute money or money's worth to a common stock and employ it for the common purpose. Because after industrial revolution, the joint stock company plays a important role in the production system. Then what are the features of a joint stock company? Corporate personality, joint capital, share capital, transferability of share, limited liability, statutory responsibility, number of shareholders, independent nature of management, democratic norm, profit distribution, tax payment, dissolutions. These are the features of a joint stock company. It is a corporate personality, joint capital and share capital, transferability of the shares and limited liability, the statutory responsibility. The number of shareholders are limited and independent nature of the management, democratic norm, and it is a profit distribution, tax payment and dissolution. Then the next one is, what are the types of joint stock companies? We should know the definition, then we should know the features. Now we should know the types of joint stock companies. The types of joint stock company we divided into 5 types, majorly focused on the 3, but generally we classified into the 5 types. What is that? Chartered company, statutory company, registered company, government company and non-government companies. Registered company, we classified under the 2 types, limited company and unlimited company. Again, the limited company divided into private limited company, public limited company. Again, the public limited company classified through the company limited by the shares, then company limited by the guarantee, company limited by shares and company limited by guarantee. Then we should go for the one by one. What is the meaning of chartered company? The meaning of chartered company is, in 1844, the first Company Act was issued in the England. A chartered company is a company which is incorporated by royal charter obtained from the crown. This type of company is in vogue in England a century ago. Then what are the examples of the chartered company? The examples of the chartered company is Chartered Bank of England, Chartered Merchant Bank of India, third one, East India Company. So we should know the meaning of chartered company. Several times this question asked for the short answer question. So what is the meaning of chartered company? In 1844, the first company act was issued in England, which is incorporated by the royal charter obtained from the crown. This type of company is in the vogue of England a century ago. Then what are the examples of the chartered company? The examples of the chartered company is Chartered Bank of England, Chartered Mercantile Bank of India, then East India Company. Then the second one is statutory companies. What is the meaning of statutory companies? These companies are incorporated by a special act passed by the central or state legislature. The statutory companies are incorporated by a special act passed by the central or state legislature. Examples. What are the examples of the statutory companies? Reserve Bank of India, State Bank of India, Industrial Finance Corporation, Unit Trust of India, State Trading Corporation, and LIC, Life Insurance Corporation, are the some of the examples of statutory companies. The statutory companies are incorporated by a special act and passed by the central government or central legislature or state legislature. Then what are the examples? Reserve Bank of India, Unit Trust of India, State Bank of India, Industrial Finance Corporation, State Trading Corporation, and Life Insurance Corporation are some of the examples of the statutory companies. Then these companies do not have any memorandum or articles of association. We should go through in the next slide. What is the meaning of memorandum of association and articles of association? And the statutory companies, deriving their powers from the acts constituting them and enjoy certain powers, that companies incorporated under the Companies Act, Then the next one is registered company. What is the meaning of registered company? A company which is formed and registered under the Companies Act 2013, including the companies which are earlier registered under any of the previous company, are called as incorporated or registered company. A company which is registered under the Companies Act 2013. What is the difference between statutory company? Statutory company is incorporated under the chartered companies, incorporated under the 1844, whereas statutory companies are incorporated under the state or central legislatures. Registered company is under the Companies Act 2013, including the companies which are registered under any previous company, is called incorporated or registered companies. All those companies which do not fall under the above categories are called unregistered company. So you should know the difference between registered company and unregistered company. Registered company is registered under the Companies Act 2013, and it is, whereas unregistered companies means it is not registered under the Companies Act. The next one is limited companies. First we should know the meaning of limited company. What is the meaning of limited company? Definition. What is the definition of limited company? Owned by shareholders and commonly run on a day-to-day basis by paid employees, It is owned by shareholders and run on a day-to-day basis by paid employees. Next one is public limited company and private limited company. First, we should know the meaning of public limited company. Then we should know the meaning of private limited company. Public limited companies means can sell shares to the general public on the stock exchanges. They are selling their shares to the general public on the stock exchanges. That is called the public limited company. Whereas private limited companies, that generally we called it as a limited companies. In general, you are seeing sometimes in the boards, limited company. Or sometimes you are seeing in the newspapers, limited companies. Can only sell shares to individuals on the agreement of all existing shareholders. That means it should not be more than 50 shareholders. It should not be more than 50 shareholders. It should not be more than 50 shareholders. Public limited companies, private limited companies. Then unlimited company. Unlimited company. Unlimited company. The company may have a share capital and is rarely used as a trading company. It has been used for mutual funds where the company holds assets as investments among the shareholders. If a shareholder wishes to leave, he may sell back to his shares to the company. So that means limited company, we classified into the private limited company and public limited company. Public limited company is through stock exchanges. Private limited company means through selling their shares through the individually, but it should not be sold more than 50 shareholders. Unlimited company means the company or may not have a share capital and rarely used for the trading purpose. It is used generally in the mutual funds where the company holds assets as investments among the shareholders. If a shareholder wants to leave or wishes to leave, he may sell back his shares to the company. That is called the unlimited company. Then, what is the difference between limited by guarantee and limited by shares? Limited by guarantee and limited by shares. Limited by guarantee and limited by shares, we can classify it on the basis of the purpose, structure, processing time of incorporation, minimum individual required, annual financial statement submission, annual return submission, then contribution type. So first we classified on the basis of the purpose, limited by guarantee and limited by share. Limited by guarantee is non-profit oriented, whereas limited by shares is a profit oriented. Limited by guarantee is non-profit oriented, whereas limited by shares is a profit oriented. Then the structure is limited by guarantee is director and member guarantor, company secretary. Whereas in the limited by shares is a director and shareholder, owner. So what is the difference here? In the limited by guarantee is a member, limited by share is a shareholder. And how much processing time is taking in the limited by guarantee? It takes 1 month, but whereas limited by shares is around, it takes 2 to 10 working days. Minimum individual required. At least two directors and two members are the required for the guarantee. Whereas in the limited by shares is limited by at least one director and one member. Then annual financial submission statement in both the cases, that means limited by guarantee and limited by shares, must be submission is needed. Annual return of submission, that is also must. Annual financial statement, annual return submission, both limited by guarantee and limited by shares, must be submission. Then contribution type. Contribution type in the limited by guarantee is guarantee, whereas here is in the share capital form. In the share capital form. So that is the difference between limited by guarantee and limited by shares. Then what are the advantages of a joint stock company? The joint stock company advantages is, American business suggests that this forms certain advantages. What are the advantages is, high amount of capital can be generated, limited liability, low risk investment, perpetual succession, separate entity, transferability of shares, efficient management, and credit facility. So then what are the advantages of a joint stock company? As per the American business suggested that it is a high amount of capital, limited liability, low risk investment, perpetual succession, separate entity, transferability of shares, efficient management, credit facility, efficient management and credit facility. These are the advantages of the joint stock company. Then what are the disadvantages of a joint stock company? The disadvantages of this joint stock company is complexity of information, creation of monopoly business, bureaucracy, nepotism, high administrative cost, overlook to the shareholder, scope of fraud, tied following of law, expose of secrecy. Expose of secrecy. These are the major disadvantages of a joint stock companies. Complexity formation, bureaucracy, administrative cost, scope of the fraud, expose of secrecy, tied of following the law. These are the major disadvantages of a joint stock company. So up to now what we discussed about the what is meant by joint stock company, what are the features of a joint stock company, then types of joint stock companies, then we discussed about the chartered company, statutory company, then we discussed about the public limited company, private limited company, then unlimited company, then limited by guarantee and limited by shareholders, then what are the advantages and disadvantages of a joint stock company. This question asked several times for 5 marks question. Please write down in this structure. Next one is memorandum of association. Memorandum of association, generally we call it as MOUs. MOU, memorandum of association of a company, is its charter and defines the limitations of the powers of a company. It contains the fundamental condition upon which alone the company is allowed to be incorporated. Allow the company to be incorporated. It charters and defines the limitations of the powers of a company. It contains the fundamental condition which alone the company is allowed to be incorporated. That is called the memorandum of association. Short answer question, several times asked, MOU. Then the next one is articles of association. What is the meaning of articles of association? The articles of association, what is the meaning of article? Article means the articles of association of a company as originally framed or as altered from time to time in pursuance of any previous company's laws or of this act, that is the articles of association. Then what is the difference between memorandum of association and articles of association? For examination point of view, very important, memorandum of association's conditions upon which the company is incorporated, whereas articles of association is internal regulations of the company, whereas memorandum of association is, it is subordinate to the act only, whereas articles of association is subordinate to the act as well as the memorandum, Memorandum of association is, it is to filled by all types of companies, whereas articles of association is public companies limited by share need, not file. Memorandum of association is, can number be easily altered, whereas the articles of association, we cannot be altered, And whereas in the memorandum of association, it defines the relationship between company, outsiders, example, that means creditors, buyers, these are all come under the memorandum of association. It defines the relationship between company and outsider. Example is creditors and buyers. Whereas articles of association is, it governs the internal relationship between company and members. So that is the difference between memorandum of association and articles of association. The next one is, what is the meaning of prospectus? Prospectus. You are all seeing in the newspaper sometimes IPO. IPO means initial public offering. Prospectus means any document prescribed and issued as prospectus by the company. It includes any notice, circular, advertisement, any other document, inviting deposits or offers from the public for subscription of any shares in the corporation. It is also known as initial public offering or offer document. This question asked several times for short answer question. What is the meaning of prospectus? Prospectus, we can also call it as a initial public offering or offer document. It means any document prescribed and issued as prospectus by the company. It includes any notice, circular, advertisement or any other document inviting deposits or offers from the public for subscription of any shares in the corporation. The next one is meaning of cooperative society. The term cooperation derived from the Latin word cooperare, where the word co means with, operare means to work. That means cooperation means to working together. Working together, it means those who want to work together with some common economic objective. Can form a society which is termed as cooperative society. Then what are the features of a cooperative society? The futures of cooperative society is open membership, voluntary association, state controlling, sources of finance, democratic management, service motive, distribution of surplus, self-help through mutual cooperation, nature of formation, number of members, legal entity. These are the futures of the cooperative society. Open membership, voluntary association, state control, sources of finance, democratic management, service motive, distribution of surplus, self-help through mutual cooperation, nature of formation, number of members and legal entity. These are the features of cooperative society. The next one is limited liability company. This question asked several times for 5 marks question. What is the meaning of limited liability company? A company can be defined as an artificial person, invisible, intangible, created by or under law with a discrete legal entity, perpetual succession and a common seal. It is not affected by death, insanity or insolvency of an individual member. So then what is the meaning here? It may be either artificially persons or invisible or intangible, unseeable, created by under the law with a discrete legal entity, perpetual succession. But due to death or insanity or insolvency. What is the meaning of insolvency? Insolvency means unable to or repayable capacity is no. There is no repayable capacity is not there. That is called the insolvency. Then a company is called as a limited liability company because the liability of its members is limited to the amount that they have agreed to contribute to the company by way of share capital. Then what are the advantages and disadvantages of the limited liability company? The advantages and disadvantages of the limited liability company. The advantages is limited liability is choice of taxation, flexible ownership of rules, flexible profit or loss distribution, operating flexibility. Whereas the disadvantage is there is no stock, limited lifespan, fewer incentives, taxes, paperwork less than corporation but more than proprietary ship. That is the disadvantages of the limited liability company. So there are some of the advantages and some of the disadvantages are there for the limited liability company. But flexible ownership rules, flexible profit or loss, operation distribution, operation flexibility is more in the advantages for the limited liability company. Then what are the sources of capital for a company? The sources of capital for a company is commercial banks, commercial finance companies, leasing companies, state and local government lending programs, trade credit and peer-to-peer lending, private investors, institutional venture capital firms, strategic investors and corporate venture capitalists. Commercial banks, finance companies, leasing companies, state and local government lending companies, trade credits, private investors, institutional venture capitals and strategic ventures, investors. These are the sources of the capital for a company. Then non-conventional sources of finance. Non-conventional sources of finance we classified into the three types: long-term finance, medium-term finance and short-term finance. Then what are the long-term finance? Long-term finance is own capital, share capital, retained profits, long-term loans and debentures. First we should go through the one by one. What are the long-term finances? Long-term loans. Long-term loans, these are specialized financial institutions offering long-term loans. Provided the business purpose proposals is if it is feasible. Feasible means economically. They can get profit or not, they can estimate in advance. The promoter should be able to offer assets of the business as security to avail of the source. Security to avail of the source, that is the long-term loans. Long-term loans is a specialized financial institutions offering long-term loans, providing the business proposals is feasible. The promoter should be able to offer assets of the business as security to avail of the source. Then, own capital. In the long-term finance, we divided own capital. First one is the own capital. Own capital means the investors or partnership members or sole trader, they are investing their money. The owners of the business have invested their own finances to start with. Money invested by the owners, investors or promoters in permanent and will stay with the business throughout the life of the business. That is the own capital. They cannot withdraw their money at any time. Why? Because they want to continue their business in a long-term opportunity. Next one is share capital. Then we divided into the share capital into two types. What are that? One is the preference share capital and another one is the equity share capital. Preference share capital is the holder of these shares do not enjoy any voting right except at their class meeting. There is no voting rights for the preference shareholders. Whereas in the general equity shareholders enjoying the voting rights and payment of dividend, the holders of these shares have the preference right as to the payment of dividend. Equity shareholders get the dividend after the payment of the preference shareholders. Repayment of capital. The holders of these cash shares have the preference right as to repayment of preference share capital. Repayment of capital in the equity share is to made after making repayment to the profaner shareholders. First priority to the preference shareholders. Then rate of dividend. In the preference shareholders, the rate of dividend is fixed. But whereas in the equity shareholders, the rate of dividend vary from year to year. It may not be similar all the years. In the 1 year it may increase, 1 year it may decrease, or it may constant. It is vary from year to year. Then convertibility. Convertibility, preference shares easily converted to the equity shares. But whereas the equity shares, we cannot be converted to the other types of shares. Once we are investing the money into the equity share means we cannot be converted. But whereas preference share capital, we can easily converted. Then redemption. Redemption, the preference of redeemable during the life of the company. During the life of the company. Whereas equity shareholders not redeemable during the lifetime of the company. Not during the lifetime of the company. So this question asked several times for short answer question and essay type question. In the short answer question, they asked about only the preference share capital or only they asked about the equity share capital. In the 5 marks question, it asked about the distinguish between preference share capital and equity share capital. Then what are the points you should write down? You should write down the voting rights, payment of dividend, repayment of capital, rate of dividend, convertibility, redemption. These are the points which you classify and distinguish between the preference share capital and equity share capital. Then retained profits. Retained profits. Retained profits are the profits remaining after all the claims. The farms are very significant source of finance. Retained farms is a good source of working capital. Particularly in times of growth and expansion, retained profits can be advantageously utilized. Retained means after claiming all the profits, the amount can be played an important role for the development of the organization or for the good source of the working capital. What is the meaning of working capital? Working capital means current assets minus current liabilities for day-to-day expenditures or day-to-day cost. Particularly, it is used in the growth of the organization and advantageously utilizing these retained profits. Next one is debenture. A debenture is a unit of loan amount. When a company intends to raise the loan amount from the public, it issues debentures. It bears the date of redemption, rate and mode of payment of interest. A person holding debenture or debenture is called a debenture holder. A debenture holder is always the creditor of the company. Creditor of the company. A debenture is a document issued under the seal of the company. Under the seal of the company. A debenture is a unit of loan amount which intends the loan amount from the public. It issues the debentures and those who are holding that money, that we called it as a debenture holder, and he is the creditor of the company, and the document is issued under the seal of the company. Then what we discussed? We discussed in the long-term finances, own capital, share capital. Share capital, again we divided into two types. What are that? Preference share capital, equity share capital. Retained profits. Then we discussed about the debentures. Next, second one is medium term finance. What is the medium term finance? The medium term finance examples are the bank loans, hire purchase, leasing or renting, venture capital. Bank loans, hire purchasing, leasing or renting, venture capital. Then what is the meaning of medium term? The medium term means it is in between 5 to 10 years. Whereas long term means more than 10 years. And the next one is bank loan. So in the medium term finance, the first one is a bank loan. It is made by a bank to be repaid with interest on or before a fixed date, a major function of the commercial bank. That means they are issuing the loans on the basis of the repayable capacity, and they should also pay with the principal plus interest on the fixed date. So that is the function of the commercial banks issuing the loans. And these loans are always useful for the productive purpose. Useful for the productive purpose. Maybe carrying the crop through harvest, or we can also call it as carrying an inventory, or you can also call used as the crops, or and the loan could be repayable. The loan could be repayable. Next one is hire purchase. First one is bank loan. Second one is hire purchase. Hire purchase is used to buy expensive items which a person cannot afford to pay out right. Pay out to right. Example, car purchasing. A down payment is usually paid and the balance is paid over several months. That is generally we called it as a monthly installment. What is hire purchase? Here possession of goods is transferred immediately, but payment is made in installments. Ownership is transferred after all the installments have been paid. Then that is called the hire purchase. Hire purchase is used for expensive items and which a person cannot afford to pay out right at a time, and they can be issued through the monthly installments. The next word is leasing or renting. Leasing or renting. When there is a need for fixed assets, the asset need to be purchased. It can be taken in the form of lease or rent for specified number of years. The company who owns the assets is called the lessor, and the company which takes the assets on lease is called the lessee. This question also asked several times. Difference between lessor and lessee. Lessor means the company who owns the asset is called the lessor, and the company which takes an asset on lease is called the leasee. Next one, venture capital. For examination point of view, very, very important for short answer questions. What is the meaning of venture capital? The meaning of venture capital is a long-term risk capital to finance high technology projects which involve risks but at the same time strong potential for growth. Strong potential for growth. It is a high technology based project and high risk is involved, but the potential of growth is very high. That type of investment we called it as a venture capital investment. Venture capital investors are professional investors who pool their resources, including managerial abilities, to assist new entrepreneurs in early years of project. That is called the venture capital. And what is the definition of venture capital? A financing institution which joins an entrepreneur as a co-promoter in a project, share the risks and rewards of an enterprise. That is the venture capital. Then the next one is short-term finance. Short-term finance, the first one is commercial paper. Commercial paper is an unsecured paper. It is issued for short-term loan, or it is issued in the form of the promissory note. It is issued by large companies and at a discount rate. The commercial paper sales use it to finance as a working capital. Just now we discussed what is the meaning of working capital. It is based on current market interest rates. It is not fixed. It is based on the current market interest rates. Average maturity of commercial paper is in between 1 and 2 months. In between 1 and 2 months. Maturities on commercial paper are usually no longer than 9 months. That means maximum it should not be exceeded 9 months. Generally the maturity average is 1 month to 2 months. Commercial paper is issued by wide variety of domestic and foreign firms, including finance companies, banks and industrial firms. Next, bank overdraft. It occurs when withdrawals from a bank account exceed the available balance. This gives the account a negative balance and the bank is providing credit. Banks also offer overdraft facility. It is credit limit on which bank and client agree on the opening of the account. And if the amount overdrawn is within this authorized overdraft, then interest is normally charged at the agreed rate. Agreed rate, that is called the bank overdraft. Then the last one is trade credit. Trade credit. Trade credit refers to the credit extended by the suppliers of goods in normal course of business. What are the normal course of businesses? They extended suppliers of goods is normal course of business. What are the advantages and disadvantages of business? The trade credit. Advantages of the trade credit is easy and convenient, and it is flexible. Flexible means credit increases with growth of the firm. Credit increases with growth of the firm. Informal and spontaneous source. Spontaneous means immediately they are distributing or immediately they are issuing the source. But then what is the disadvantage of the trade credit? Higher prices by suppliers and loss of cash discount. That is the major disadvantage for the trade credit. Then next one is debt factoring. What is the meaning of debt factoring? The meaning of debt factoring is it involves a firm which has sold goods on credit selling its debts to another business specializing in collecting debts. Debt factoring means it collects the firm which has sold goods on credit selling its debts to another business specializing in collecting debts. Then what are the advantages? The advantages is ensures early payment, reduces uncertainty, the factor takes on bad debts, reduces need for overdraft, reduces cost of chasing the late payments. Then what are the disadvantages? The disadvantages is the factor buys at a discount, but typically it should pay 80% of the value of the debtors, and in addition will charge a fee. They are charging the fee for 5% of the debt. 5% of the debt additionally they are charging under the total percentage of 80% of the value of the debtors. So that is the disadvantage for the debt factoring. Advantages and disadvantages of the debt factoring. So these are the non-conventional sources of finance. The non-conventional sources of finance we divided into three types: long-term finance, medium-term finance, and short-term finance. This question asked several times for essay type question, and some of the questions are also asked for the short answer question. What are that? Commercial paper they asked, bank overdraft asked several times. Commercial paper, bank overdraft, then they asked about the leasing or renting, or some earlier they asked about the venture capital. So thank you, my dear students. And today, whatever the topic we discussed in the business topic, the session 2 examination point of view, very important, because most of the essay questions and most of the short answers are coming from this particular session. It will be more useful for you examination point of view. Once again, you please go through all the videos, then it will be easy for remembrance of the each and every term. What is the meaning of the term, where it is used, then what are the advantages, what are the disadvantages involved. So this is the today topic what we discussed. This is the session 2 topic. So up to now we completed the business. So in the unit 1 we divided the 2 parts. First part is the business. The business, again we classified the 2 sessions, session 1 and session 2. Session 1 what we discussed? We discussed about the what is the meaning of business, what is the meaning of economics, what is the differences, what are